Let us pray. O Lord, we pray that you will open our ears, our eyes, and our hearts to what you have for us today. Amen. Our first scripture reading today is from 1 John chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ has been born of God, and everyone who loves the parent loves the child. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we obey his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome, for whatever is born of God conquers the world. And this is the victory that conquers the world, our faith. Who is it that conquers the world but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not with water only, but with the water and the blood. And the Spirit is the one that testifies, for the Spirit is the truth. This is the word of God. Our second scripture today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 9 through 17. This is familiar to you, I'm sure. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you, so that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. I am giving you these commands, so that you may love one another. This is the word of the Lord.
Yes, this Mother's Day, I thought I'd better have my mom read scripture so that way she wouldn't interrupt the sermon. She just promises much. A little boy forgot his lines during a Sunday school play. Who likes standing in front of people that can't remember what you're supposed to say? Fortunately, he had his mother sitting in the front row, and she knew his lines. And so she was gesturing and mouthing the lines, but he had completely forgotten what he was supposed to say. That wasn't working, so she leaned forward and she whispered the line, "I am the light of the world." So, all of a sudden, we got a look of radiance across his face. He turns to the audience and with a big booming voice, he says, "My mom is the light of the world." Mothers are incredible beings. Irma Bombeck. Remember Irma Bombeck? She used to write columns on the family. For those of you younger than 40, if you have children and have never heard of Irma Bombeck, I suggest you go find her, one of her books. You will enjoy them immensely. One of her most well-known articles was titled, "When God Created Mothers." And she wrote, "When the good Lord was creating mothers, he was into his sixth day of overtime. angel approached and said, "You're doing a lot of fiddling on this one." And the Lord said, "Have you read the specs on this order? She has to be completely washable, but not plastic. Have 180 movable parts, all replaceable. Run on black coffee and leftovers. Have a laugh that disappears when she stands up. A kiss that can cure everything from a broken arm to a broken heart. And 6 pairs of hands." The angel shook her head slowly and said, "6 pairs of hands? No way." The Lord said, "It's not the hands that are the problem. It's the 3 sets of eyes she's required to have that are causing the problem." One thing in particular that I have learned about mothers is that mothers tend to be fairly protective of their own children. Is that fair to say? I learned this as a youth pastor when I discovered that a mom can say and claim anything she wants to say about her own children, that you better not say anything. And we've all learned there are certain things that we can't really tell our moms. Because when we do, well, moms can't help but to get involved. They just have this sense that they need to defend. They're always in our corners. Moms often are the ones that support and encourage us. They seem to see the best in us when no one else can. Moms are always there. Now, I bring this up not just because it's Mother's Day, but also because often what we see in moms reminds us of the essence of what the good news is all about. That if we could use one word to describe what the good news is, it would be love. We even talk about the essence of God as being love. We love to cite the verse, 1 John 4:8. "Whoever does not love does not know God. For God is love." Generally speaking, we just talk about the last 3 words. Love to remind and say, God is love. That's all right. Because the heart of the good news is that. And while moms are not God, they often are the ones that demonstrate the love of God for us. This idea, though, of God is love, let's think about that for a moment, because that is a really deep, meaningful statements. When we say God is love, we're not just really saying God loves. God does that. But love is not just an attribute of love. When we say God is love, we are saying the essence of God is love. That God must love. God must always love. Did you know that one of the basic foundational principles for why the doctrine of the Trinity is developed was this idea out of God is love? Because who was there for God to love prior to creation? Community of God that has always existed. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The lover, the beloved, and the love that they share. God is an eternally living example of mutual self-surrendering love. That is the relationship which exists between each person of the Trinity. And we know this because says as much in the passage today. But then Jesus goes on and says something really great. Jesus invites us into that relationship too. When Jesus says, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. We are witnesses to the love of God. We have experienced the love of God through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But one of the ongoing questions throughout Scripture deals with the second part of that sentence that Jesus says. Abide in my love. How do we abide in God's love? How do we stay and remain in God's love? Adam and Eve, they experienced God's love, but how do we stay in the garden? The Israelites experienced God's love by being liberated from Egypt in the Exodus. How do you remain in the promised land? Jesus gives us an answer in this passage today. His answer is as challenging as it is simple. And it is simple, for he simply says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Now, I want to make sure that you hear what he says there, so I'm going to differentiate from what he does not say. He did not say here, if you keep my commandments, then I will love you. No, God loves you. God loves you unconditionally. It's not about if God loves you, it's about us abiding in God's love. This week I read a story about a boy who had a one-eyed mother. She was a single mom, and so they barely were able to make ends meet. And the boy was rather ashamed of their life situation. And frankly, he was embarrassed by his one-eyed mother. And one day at school, it was field day at school, and his one-eyed mother, to his horror, showed up. He gave her a hateful glance and ran out. So embarrassed. The next day, all of the kids mocked him, being the child of the one-eyed mother. He grew to hate his mom. He couldn't wait until he was old enough to get out of there and make a life of his own. And that's exactly what he did. As soon as he was old enough, he left, went to the city, married, had children, had a good job by all measures of how the world measures success. He was living a successful life. And one day, there was a knock at his door. It was a one-eyed woman, his mom. His daughter opened the door, and she screamed. One-eyed woman scared. The son of the one-eyed woman came to the door and said, who are you? I don't know. The mom said, I'm sorry, I must have the wrong house. A while later, the man was invited to a reunion. And since he had lived a successful life, he couldn't wait to go back to the reunion. So he jumped at that opportunity, went back to his hometown, went to the reunion. After the reunion, for some reason, I'm not sure what, maybe he felt a sense of guilt or something, but he went to the shack where his mom lived. And he found her, lifeless on the ground, clutching a piece of paper. He grabbed that piece of paper, and with a piece of paper, it turned out to be a letter. A letter to him. in which she said, "My son, I miss you so much. I'm sorry that I have been an embarrassment for you. But when you were a little boy, you had an accident and you lost an eye. I couldn't imagine you going through life without an eye, so I gave you one of mine. As a mother, I am so proud of you that you have been able to see a whole new world for me in my place with that eye. I miss you so much. I love you. You are the world." This boy was loved by his mom. Didn't matter what he did or didn't do, she loved him. But he did not abide in her love. May that never happen in our relationship with God. May we learn to abide in God's love, to know and experience this love that God has for us. So how is it that we abide in God's love again? Jesus said, "Obey my commandments." And what are the commandments that Jesus gives us? Love God and love one another. In 1 Corinthians, we're reminded that we can have everything in the world, but if we don't have love, we have nothing. Nothing. So if we want to abide in God's love, the way we do so is clear. We love. We love God and we love each other. Love should be the identifying trait of each and every Christian, just as we hope that love is the identifying trait of every mom. So when people come to church, when they visit the body of Christ, they shouldn't feel judged. What they should experience, what they should see is love. That's what we are commanded to do. Is it simple? Yes. Is it easy? Hardly. Loving others the way that God loves us, it is challenging. All you have to do is look at a mother of any young child. And what you see written all over her face, probably it looks a little tired. Probably very worried and anxious. Maybe a little overwhelmed at times. But you know what? They can't imagine their life without that child. Their entire world. They wouldn't trade it for their children. And so it is for each and every one of us following Jesus' command to love. For loving God and loving others, it will stretch us. It will overwhelm us. It will make us feel tired. There will be times when we frankly don't want to do it. But when we do, we will discover that there is nowhere else we would rather be. For we will be part of the community of love. God's community. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit abiding in God's love. Let's pray. May people who are part of our congregation, or who are coming into our congregation here at Westminster, may they experience the good news about the God who is love And who loves that? And that they know this because of the love that they experience through the body